A meeting of the Glasgow firemen yesterday. They have now been on strike for a week. It's the first time in the history of the fire service that firemen have gone on strike in a British city, and they've done so in Glasgow, in the city with the worst fire record in the country, the city in which 48 people have already died in fires this year. Glasgow firemen get £29 a week. They're asking for an additional £5 for working in Glasgow. They were offered £2. They rejected it and went on strike. But their strike is unofficial. Their union is against it. But yesterday, the Glasgow firemen decided to continue their strike.
I'm duty bound to ask you if you're still of the opinion of carrying on and the fight for an improved offer.
The Army, the Navy and the Air Force have been called in to man the services that the firemen have abandoned. Many of the servicemen have experience in fighting fires, fires in ships, tanks and planes. None of them have experience in fighting fires in a city like Glasgow. Some of them have never fought a fire in their lives before. There are no more red fire engines on the streets of Glasgow. Their places have been taken by the big green fire trucks, 20 years old, affectionately called the Green Goddesses. They've been taken out of mothballs to deal with the emergency. They're simple to handle and easy to drive. The modern fire engine is too complicated a piece of machinery for the average serviceman to handle. Whilst the Green Goddesses speed off to the fires, the fire engines sit in their stalls and the firemen picket the fire station. You're all public servants and you're firemen in the city which is regarded as being the most dangerous city in the whole of the country for fires.
Thunderbox City.
Why do you have to go on strike? Why do you have to jeopardise the lives and the property of thousands of people for a claim of £5 a week? Why do you have to do it?
Because we're poor, and that's putting it straight on the line. We're poor. We can't afford to stay in this job. There's a man there said 200 men left this job last year. I can't afford now. If I don't get this £5 a week, I must leave this job. We've just come to the stage where we cannot afford to work in this station anymore. It's unfortunate. We want to work, but we must have the money to pay for all the living.
Can we put this point? We are exploited men. As you were saying to Charlie, the lives of thousands of men or thousands of people in a city at danger. Fine. And believe me, we have given Glasgow years of dedication. I can't say how many years of dedication.
How do you feel about the army moving into the
Nothing.
Jobs?
We're sorry Nothing, for them. Yeah. And the only thing I do say is this. I sincerely hope that not one of these men get hurt, because no harm to them, but they're green. They're green, they lack experience. The firemen know it, the senior officers know it. The senior officers are running to the ground, watching the men as well as the fire. And it's unfortunate, and I sincerely hope, and I think every man here hopes, that none of these lads get hurt.
If there were a major fire and lives were lost, would you feel in any way responsible?
We would be funny firemen if we didn't feel a conscience in the sense of the word, that we want to see no one hurt. But at the same time, why should exploitation be carried so far that the onus is continually putting them in for dedication without remuneration?
But you would feel remorseful if lives were lost as a result of your
action? Of course, we feel remorseful if lives are lost when we're working.
Don't forget that every time a fireman turns out to a fire, in fact every minute that he's working on his shift, his life's in imminent danger. Now, we have been accused of irresponsibility for going on strike, but we are the people who in the middle of the night wear breathing apparatus, crawl up smoky dwelling houses, rescue people. That man there's a turntable ladder operator, drives a heavy fire engine through the city in the middle of the night, sometimes exhausted, weaving in and out of traffic. Is these the actions of irresponsible men? We have about 26 men lying up the top of Necropolis Hill. Is that our irresponsible men that did that? The Glasgow firemen have given sufficient dedication to this city to merit a decent living wage. Now, my last wage before this strike started was in a 48-hour week, and I took home £21. And I've been a fireman for over 3 years.
Do you think that these firemen are right going on strike?
I think they're quite right. I don't say she get £5, I say she get blooming £10.
Glasgow has, on average, 50 fire calls a day, and the average hasn't dropped just because the firemen are on strike. Not all of them are serious blazes. Many are small incidents like a chimney on fire. But in a city like Glasgow, where much of the property is old and derelict, a small fire can quickly become a raging inferno if not dealt with immediately.
Give us the hose reel off this machine.
Hose reel open.
The firemen are on strike, but their officers are not. They supervise the operation and show the men on the spot how to do the job. Without them, there would be chaos.
Now, two firemen, come on, two firemen.
Fire officers feel the effects of the strike almost as much as the firemen who normally serve under them. What did you think when you saw the soldiers come in last week?
This was Friday, last Friday evening, 6 o'clock. I thought the world had dropped out of Glasgow. A lump in the throat, the tears in the eyes. It maybe sounds dramatic, but that's exactly how I felt. I think that any Glasgow fireman that was in here on duty on that day must, in all honesty, have had a lump at his throat, because I certainly had.
Why did you feel like that?
An end of an era, if you like to say that. It was, at that particular time, disbandment of the Glasgow Fire Service. It was like packing your case and walking out and letting someone else walk into their place. Because personally, I've been in this brigade for 10 years, and I never thought and didn't want to see anybody take my place as a firefighting unit in this city.
I think that's a lot of truth in that, Stuart. In fact, I was on duty at a fire station when the troops arrived. And personally, for some unknown reason, I felt a wee bit hostile towards them, because it seemed that strangers were coming into my fire station, and 2 minutes previous to the troops arriving, most of the firemen who belonged to the station were standing outside picketing, all well-kent faces, and here arrived on, or descended on the fire station. Servicemen with various dresses, petty officers from the Royal Navy, Army, RAF types, all with the queer-looking bits of uniform. Not that you could call them a uniform, just a battle dress here, a pair of dungarees. You never knew actually who they were, apart from the headgear they were wearing. And here they were boldly marching into my fire station, taking over. I felt a bit sad, yes, a bit. Yeah, you see, we're now at a fire where normally at a fire we would take a calculated risk, which might mean a wee bit danger. We don't take those risks now at all. In fact, instruction has gone out from the headquarters that we can't even injure ourselves at the moment during this crisis, because we can't afford to have an officer off duty.
What has this strike, or what will this strike, have done to the Glasgow Fire Brigade? Not just to the officers, but to the men, to the whole brigade?
In the long run, it must, whether you want to say it or not, it must, and I'm afraid to say it, it must damage the image of the fire, it must damage the image of the Glasgow Fire Service.
Even a simple operation like putting out a smoking chimney is complicated if you've never done it before. Even a simple operation like tying a rope round a hose pipe to hoist it up to the smoking chimney has its problems.
Hey, John! Right!
Just press it off.
This was your house, was it?
Yes.
What happened?
I was putting on the fire, son. I was writing a letter to Dublin and one to my cousins in quarantine. And I put the blower on it, brrr, you know, blew the blower back.
Did you know that there were no firemen, that the firemen were on strike?
I knew they were on strike. That's why I would like to get them getting a fair chance in life for the risk every minute.
Do you think that these soldiers, these servicemen, are capable
of... Are they soldiers?
Of... Yes, didn't you know that?
Never knew that.
These aren't firemen. These are men from the armed services.
Oh, never knew that.
Billy Martin is a fireman. He earns £26 for a 48-hour week. He and his wife Anne have four children.
I feel I must support Billy, and not only Billy, all the firemen, and I think all firemen's wives feel the same. They've been used long enough. I mean, there's many a fireman goes out and a chance of losing his life. And I would be without Billy, without money, then. So being without money for a few weeks and having Billy here means more to me than losing Billy. You know, I mean, I think they're justified in what they're doing. I mean, I've taken a job myself, you know, only 3 weeks, because I felt this strike was inevitable.
Have you thought of packing it in?
Not until recently, no. These past few weeks have been hard with this work to roll. You know, the money has been very, very tight. It's getting tighter, it's going to be even tighter next week. But there's nothing else we can do. This is... You've got to fight for your existence, and this is what we are doing, fighting for it.
They've got to realise that when a fire engine is going down the road, I mean, it's lovely to see everybody turns over a fire engine, but I don't think half people realise what these men are going to face. They might be going to face a chimney, they might be going to face a blaze like there was at the docks 2 or 3 weeks ago. I mean, the heat's intense. The smoke sometimes cripples their lungs. And sometimes Billy comes home and his lungs are choked with smoke. And it takes him 2 or 3 days to get over it. But he's still got to go to his work, he's still got to report on duty. These are things I don't think people realise. They think a fireman goes to a fire, turns on a hose and works magic. They don't realise they've got to go into the building, right in the building, where the smoke is thick, black, and get to the source of the fire and put that fire out.
If the job is so dangerous, and if the pay is so bad, why haven't you tried to persuade Billy to do something completely different? A job which has security, a job which doesn't have any danger, and a job which is better paid.
Well, first of all, Billy enjoys his job, and it's Billy's choice to be a fireman. And I'm a proud woman that he is a fireman. To me, someday a house might go on fire, there may be children in that house. And if I thought that Billy could save them, well, I'm glad he's a fireman, you know. I mean, I'm proud that he's a fireman and he wants to be one.
A few hours after they'd handled the smoking chimney, same crew were called to a real fire, the kind of fire for which Glasgow is notorious, the kind of fire in which most lives are lost, a fire in one of the city's crumbling tenement blocks. Firefighting demands caution as well as enthusiasm. One of the soldiers, in a rush of excitement, dashes up the smoke-filled staircase and is knocked unconscious by the flames. An elementary mistake that no fireman would have made.
Right. Aye, well, get him once they come with an oxygen mask and put it on.
Hey, back on!
Water on! Water on!
Fire officers give the injured soldier oxygen. They don't know yet how badly he's been hurt. Can you tell me what happened?
We were at the top of the stairs and we were pushing the hoses up and we turned the water on and the smoke all attracted to us and we got a lung full of smoke. We fell back down the stairs, and just cracked my arm. That's all was happening.
How are you feeling now?
Just a bit shaky.
Have you done this kind of job before? Have you ever been in a situation like this?
Saturday night, it was down at its house that was on fire. And we went there and he was just plain running, it was pretty straight out. And that was obviously the only fire I've been to.
Did you expect this job to be like this?
Well, we were told it would be, similar to it. We were told what to expect, we just more or less laughed at it until it happened,
Did you think that there really were so many fires in Glasgow?
No. We had two tonight within 5 minutes. One was just a dustbin on fire, now this one.
Would you like to be a Glasgow fireman, full time?
No. Stay where I am.
What do you think of the job that these firemen have to do normally?
Well, they're on strike now, and I think they're on strike for a good purpose, for the money. They deserve the money. They should get it. If they don't, I think they just should stay out of strike.
You'd rather be a soldier than a fireman, would you?
Yeah. Any day.
As public servants, and as public servants working in the fire service in Glasgow, do you not think that your responsibility must override your pay claim, your responsibility to the people of Glasgow?
He doesn't want to take a step. There is no fireman in Glasgow wants to go on strike because as a fireman in Glasgow, as I said earlier on, realises the job that he has in Glasgow. But we've been forced into this position where every Thursday when a fireman picks up his wages and discovers that he's got 20 quid, if he's lucky, he's got 20 quid. He goes back to his house, he's got a wife and family to keep. Now, eventually there must come a stage where that man, accepting the responsibility that's placed upon him as being a fireman in the Glasgow Fire Service, that he's got this responsibility to his wife and kids. And you cannot continually carry on with this responsibility because it doesn't pay the grocer's bill. It's as simple as that.
Now, by pursuing this claim, are you not simply hindering the battle that all of us face against inflation?
Now, firemen don't know about anti-inflation programmes. They certainly know that they suffer under them, but they don't know the intricacies of it. We are 200 men short in Glasgow. We have approached the Glasgow Corporation and told them that if they don't give us a substantial local increase in our wage, they will not continue to have an efficient fire service in the Tinderbox City.
If you get
what you want, or at least some of what you want, because of your strike action. What is there to stop other members who work in public service, like ambulance drivers or teachers or nurses or whatever, doing exactly what you have done and taking strike action to get what they want, because they have seen that you have been successful?
Very, very interesting, very sad that you had to mention those services, because by mentioning those services, you're also mentioning people who are in exactly the same position as us. They have a very, very responsible job, and it seems that responsibility toward public and low wages for years have been hand in hand. And if the nurses, if the ambulance men, or whoever is directly involved in the safety of the public wish to make their stand because of their appalling wages, strength of their arm.
By striking?
That is entirely up to them.
Outside Glasgow Rangers football ground last night, the strikers asked for support. Because this strike is unofficial, there is no strike pay. Because the Glasgow firemen are out on their own, there is no strike fund. In 24 hours, they have collected £2,000.
Come on, we're fighting this ourselves, lads. The union have let us down badly here. We're all sitting down in England at head office.
Thank you. Given the job that firemen have to do, and given the kind of city that Glasgow is, would you not accept that the Glasgow firemen do have a very special case?
Well, I'm the first in my admiration of the work that the fire service in Glasgow has done over the years. There's no doubt that firemen in Glasgow, as indeed elsewhere, have a very difficult task to do, and the public are very well served by them. But what I think we've got to remember in this case is that we're not talking only of Glasgow. The fire service is a national service. There are dangers equally in Liverpool, in Manchester, in London, in Dundee, and in 100,000 other places.
But what the firemen in Glasgow are worried about is that they are a special case, that they see their force being 200 men undermanned, and they see their friends and their colleagues thinking of leaving or about to leave the service. That's why they say they're a special case. That's why they believe that they have to have the money to keep the fire service going.
Well, I think it's natural that people anywhere in a particular locality may feel themselves as a special case. But I'm quite sure firemen elsewhere also feel themselves as a special case. And you see, what I think is unfortunate about Glasgow is that the firemen there should have taken this action unilaterally, on their own accord, against the advice of the union, at a very time when these problems are in process of being thrashed out with government.
We've seen the servicemen operate in Glasgow this week, and I must say that one has to admire their courage and their enthusiasm. But one also has to say that they are very inexperienced and that they are very green. If there were to be a major fire, can you honestly lay your hand on your heart and say that the services in Glasgow could cope?
Well, obviously, proper service by trained firemen, many of them with many years' experience, is the best kind of fire cover we can have. But given that the firemen in Glasgow have withdrawn that service, I do believe that the cover that we're providing is adequate for the protection of life and property in Glasgow.
This is a call for pathfinders.
So far, the troops have coped well. Several have been injured, but none seriously. So far, the troops have been lucky. They've been spared a major blaze in which lives were at stake. The servicemen are aware of their own limitations and pray that their luck will hold until the strike is settled. As Guy Fawkes night approaches, the fire risks get greater. Tonight, Glasgow is still a city without firemen. Tonight, there are still no signs of a settlement that will give Glasgow back the fire service she wants and the protection that she so desperately needs.
1800, 2359, attendances 32, fires 23, false alarms 2, false alarms malicious 7, total attendance 32, total attendance to date 250.